when you say things like 133% of poverty, that's the same equal to food stamps, which means you still gonna have to be poor to walk into a doctor's office, or you're gonna have to jump to middle class to walk into a doctor's office, or pray that some church somewhere is gonna have mercy on you and pay your bill. We cannot afford to lose any more means. Let me finish.
Please.
Of all the things I've heard talked about out of Congress, out of you today and other people, I have not heard about that medical health stuff called mental health treatment. You see, I'm, again, not here to talk for myself, because my psychiatrist doesn't return telephone calls anymore. And every emergency room is sick of seeing. I got friends at that table and family in this room, and I apologize if I've embarrassed anybody. But I'm going to that mountain like Martin. And I need to know that when I leave for that mountain, I got two kids who are grown, and when I drop dead, so goes their health insurance. And they just like me. You can't afford to lose any of them. So I stand here on my way to the mountain to say to you, we need the poor need a safe transition, not in medical health insurance, because insurance does not ensure treatment. We need a transition that ensures treatment. And it needs to have an equal and just as secure mental health component.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your passionate voice. We want to be sure that our current and future generations can look back on this time that we rose to the challenge and that we did what was right. And I also want to let you know there is provision in the bill as drafted for mental health coverage. And I want to ask Amy Bluen to talk about some of the other issues that you raised.
Thank you. Hi, Alicia. One of the things that we know about this bill is that while it's still being, you know, debated, we know that there's agreement that in addition to Medicaid up to 133% of poverty, which is going to be uniform in all states, which is a pretty big step from where we're at right now. Right now, there's a huge variation, as you know, if you've been watching the Medicaid debate in Missouri for the last several years, you know that we're currently down to 17% of the federal poverty level in the state of Missouri. So that's a big step to have that come up to that level, that required level throughout the state. But in addition to that, people who are moving and their incomes are growing, they'll have a premium subsidy for the first time to help them afford access to insurance, to help them afford access to health care. That's pretty good. What we're talking about is insurance premium subsidies up to 400% of the poverty level. So really, while your income is growing, you won't be stuck saying, no, I can't take that raise because I'm going to lose health care anymore. You know, that's a significant step forward for us.
Let's go up to the front mic again. I'm sorry, Daniel did have a comment.
The only thing I would mention is I would absolutely concur with the need to deal with mental health services. A surprisingly large percentage of people who come into the emergency rooms in St. Louis and otherwise are being seen there for psychiatric conditions. psychiatric conditions are not best treated, especially if they're chronic, in an emergency room, and we would be happy to see another way to make sure that those people get the help they need.
Let's go to our front mic. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I want to thank you, Mr. Cousin, for bringing the act and the act community to act back for people with disabilities. But we really need care because me myself haven't been to the clinic for over 2 years because I can't afford it,
system is not fair, and it's important that people with disabilities have choices and access to those community services, so thank you very much. Let's go on, let's go back, let's go to the back mic.
Yes. Representative Carnahan, thank you for having this meeting. I'd like to thank the earlier speakers who talked about responsibility and what the government has to all its citizens and dealing with reality. The reality is we are borrowing 50% of what we spend. We're already $56 trillion in the hole when it comes to Medicare and Medicaid. And we're told we need to spend more to fix the problem. Now, we all know there's a tremendous amount of fraud and misuse in the current government programs, and your answer appears to be to expand the government program. Seems to me we're throwing good money after bad. And there's very little history of the government having a program that meets the promises you were trying to make earlier and promises you're making today.